So my name is David Calhoun. As you can read, my talk is real-time satellite tracking in the browser, and not real-time in the sense as the last talk, but real-time is that in that it's updating and you can get the current location, but not like the two-way, you know, nice data binding as described in the last talk, but it's cool stuff. I'm doing some basic JavaScript. I'm not doing anything with emoji or anything like that, so as people walk out the door, it's like, oh. So sorry to disappoint you. I work at a place called Skybox Imaging, and they wanted me to show you this fancy slide with a bunch of numbers and dollar signs and stuff. I just wanted to say, like, yeah, we launched a satellite last year, which is pretty cool, a micro satellite, and we're going to launch one soon this year. That's all I want to say, so skip it. Okay, so as for products, we sell some cool stuff. We call these sky nodes on the very left side. And we sell that to customers who, you know, are interested in talking directly to our satellites and actually processing images on server racks that they actually own and control. Pretty cool. So, and we sell the imagery and video, and of course we have like an analytics component of all of that. It's cool. We have the right in mountain view. We have a clean room where we constructed the satellites. One of those is in space now, which is pretty crazy to think about. Pretty smart people working there. And as just a front end or a UI engineer, I tend to think like at places like this, I'm overwhelmed by the amount of intelligence in the room, but I'm also overwhelmed at Skybox because we have basically like rocket scientists and they talk about words I've never heard before and I have to go look them up and everything. So it's very, very humbling, very educational experience. We have this Mission Operations Center, which is right in Mountain View, too. And the screen in the very back of the room, actually, I helped develop that when I first joined Skybox. It's a telemetry dashboard. So it's pretty awesome to see them actually using that to monitor communications with the satellite as it makes a pass about every 90 minutes. And here's some cool stuff, like color infrared. And then we have this, which is, where is it? It's a little bit of a special slide. There it goes. So that's actually not an image. That's actually a video of the tallest building in the world as a plane flies by in the front. So that's pretty amazing. And that's real parallax there. It's not parallax scrolling or anything like that. Sorry, I have to say these corny jokes. And I have to say we're hiring, but I don't want to take too much time saying that. But as a UI engineer, I get to work on cool stuff, so I won't spend too much time doing this. I already mentioned the telemetry dashboard. Some of these are mapped-based, so it's actually quite useful to understand some of the orbitology and the orbital mechanics concepts behind the scenes, even if I don't fully understand the math, which I don't. I could get the words and get the terminology, and just to understand that is a huge leap. So we'll see a little bit of those concepts in this, but nothing too crazy, no heavy math. So my goal is like to actually like present something that everyone will be able to understand and build. And I gave a link to the talk actually online. So do a search for JSConf. And one of mine will be on the top list. I've uploaded the slides. I've also uploaded like step by step, so you can actually take this home and do it yourself. Nothing too crazy going on. So I just want to step backwards, literally, for like 50 years, actually over 50 years ago. So you're standing in your backyard, enjoying the dark black sky, the night sky. That's supposed to happen. That's okay. it's very early in the morning or late at night. And you tune your ham radio into the right frequency, and you look up and you see this thing going across the sky, and you hear this. Do I have audio? I don't know if you can all hear this, but you hear this strange sound. I should have checked the audio first. Anyway, it's this telemetry signal for something strange out there. What the heck is that? The year is 1957. Who knows the name of what it is? Sputnik, exactly. It's this guy, this little unimpressive guy, and that's his only job, to send that telemetry signal out. And from the comfort of your own backyard in America, wherever you are, you can see this Soviet-built satellite go up across. You can see this, and potentially it can see you. It doesn't have any optics or anything. In the middle of the Cold War, freaky as hell, like this, you know, this thing that could be an ICBM, it could have some nuclear payload, is going right over your backyard, literally. So it somehow, you know, it's like all of a sudden, suddenly it becomes quite important to know, like, what is this thing? And can I actually track where it's going to be tomorrow and the next day? Where is it going to orbit over? That suddenly becomes important. And it becomes literally front page news. So if you want to know, if you want to keep up to date, this is your main source as an amateur, you know, person who has interest in this. And actually, back then, everyone who had an interest in this, because it's quite important. And you get this one orbit track line. It shows you, OK, there's the satellite. But that's not quite helpful. It's like, OK, at one point in time, sometime yesterday or something like that, there's where the satellite was. Well, where is it right now? You know, isn't that more useful? So you keep up to date. You check in another newspaper and you see this thing that gives you more details. It's like, okay, the satellite's going to cross the 40th parallel at these times, which is relevant for America. So it's like at those times, you know, you can potentially go out in your backyard. And the Soviets were honest in saying if you had a cheap pair of binoculars and you point it in just the right area, it'd be extremely difficult, but you could actually see it, or you could see it with your eyes reflect off the sun if it was just the right timing. But that's all you had as your resources as an amateur. You had to rely on the newspaper. So like, we can't really do that nowadays. When we launch our satellites, newspapers don't really care. There's a bunch of space debris floating around up there. People, you know, newspapers aren't really excited. This is just because it was the first time, and it was especially relevant for the Cold War. So let's fast forward back to, oh, about last year in November. So, should have, oh damn, play, there we go. Oh crap, it's an ICBM. Actually, it's a decommissioned ICBM. Oh, it stopped playing. Ah, it's a decommissioned ICBM that's actually used for commercial purposes, and our satellite went up on this with a bunch of other microsatellites. And someone in my company had a good point. They said that the Russians, former Soviets, actually turned into great capitalists because they realized that they had all these ICBMs lying around, and they took out the nuclear payload, basically made contracts with countries and companies, and realized they could profit like crazy off of this. So it turned out to be fortuitous on both sides. So pretty amazing that we came from the days of Sputnik and then into the present day, where we're actually past the Cold War, and actually doing useful things with this and commercial things with this. But the goal is still the same. It's like back then, you know, I was working on a project. It happened to be a map-based project that had orbit lines and everything. But I really wanted to know, okay, how difficult is it for someone normal, reasonably normal like me, who doesn't know a lot of math, who knows basic, well, some JavaScript and can put some stuff together and mash things together. How difficult is that? So that became my goal as sort of like a hack date project. My goal is to plot the current position of SkySat-1, which is the name of our satellite, stick it on a map. Okay, let's see how far we can go. So first, we need a map. That's useful. We could use Google Maps. That's another option. We happen to use Leaflet.js, which is a little more flexible. It's like a nice alternative. Very customizable. And this is what you get straight out of the box, this pretty plain-looking map with some zoom controls, nothing too fancy. The code for this is pretty simple. I copied it straight out of their tutorial, so there's nothing fancy going on here. I set a latitude-longitude, which is just 0, 0 to make it simple. Set a zoom level. If you've ever used Google Maps, it's the same concept. Zoom of 1 just happens to be completely zoomed out, widest angle possible. And then we add a tile layer, which happens to be OpenStreetMap tiles. And then that's what we get out of it. OK, that's all well and good. But say we want to customize the tiles, and I don't like those colors, maybe. OK, we have an option to use Mapbox tiles. So Mapbox is a service that takes those OpenStreetMaps and lets you customize it, put styles on it. Not as simple as sort of like putting CSS styles on it, but they help you with a little interface. You can customize it, you can go crazy, you can do whatever you want with the colors on here. As an example, which is something I wouldn't recommend, Hello Kitty theme. If you're really into Hello Kitty, oh, that looks terrible. Okay, well, anyway, that's Hello Kitty colors. You can go crazy and customize it. It's up to your whim, basically. It's pretty simple. You log in, create an account. You get a free account to play around with. You say create a project, which ends up being your satellite tracker map, and you get an API key there. So that just happens to be my key. So I copy and paste it into my init code. So now I can take out the actual vanilla Leaflet JavaScript include, dump in map boxes, which is actually like a wrapper around Leaflet, so it takes care of everything for you. It's still Leaflet, but with some extra functions on it and with map box tiles, which is sweet, so I can customize it. The initialization is pretty much the same, a little simpler. Pass in my API key, and I'm still passing in the lat long and the zoom level. So, okay, not too crazy. So we have our map. Now, we probably want to put a custom icon on there for our satellite. So I just grabbed a little icon of that's roughly what SkySat 1 looks like with this door open. It pops open when it's in space and points down. And it's hovering over a location, it's kind of somewhere in northern Florida. I have no idea where that would be, probably around here. So I just took the latitude longitude from Amelia Island, plugged it in there, and then you can do it with this. Don't let this frighten you if you're new to JavaScript or anything. It's super simple. There's a basic example on the top. So you can say, I just want to put like the default Leaflet map marker on there. At this latitude and longitude, add it to my damn map and get it over with. Or you can say, well, I want a custom icon. So you can specify the path. You know, there's even one now for the retina or high quality displays, high pixel density displays. Specify the icon size. And then the anchor point is actually where you want to position, where you want to map the latitude, longitude relative to your actual icon. In this case, we're just putting it smack dab in the center. Some cases, you might want to put it in the upper left or so forth, but keeping it simple now. Okay, all set? I think we got everything we need, right? Oh, no, we're kind of missing some things. We're missing math, some astrophysics. Probably we're missing some more math in there, just for good measure. Probably should throw that in there. So it turns out we actually have to backtrack a bit. Just to give you the concepts, we have to do the fastest orbitology crash course in the history, and probably not one of the best, but that's cool, because you'll get a better understanding of what's going on with this math that we're going to use. So way back when the Earth was the center of the universe, at least philosophically, they actually made the math work, but with these crazy epicycle things, which end up looking like little spirograph points. So this actually was a functional, mathematically like functional working model to predict positions of planets and so forth. But they knew something was messed up. Obviously, you know, they had a philosophy that things in the heavens were perfect. It comes from philosophy. It's like the heavenly spheres and things, they're all perfect circles, perfect spheres. Obviously, this model doesn't have those perfect circles in it, so something is wrong with the model. But hey, the math works, so we'll stick with it for about 1,000 years or so, or longer. So until Copernicus comes along, and actually, the Greeks way before him actually believed in a heliocentric, sun-centered model of everything. But the heliocentric model actually rectified some of that math. So, jumping past there, took until Kepler. Kepler's first law says, okay, well, actually, these orbits that go around the sun aren't perfect circles. Turns out the heavens aren't perfect after all. Sorry to break the news to you. They're slight ellipses. They're slight. When you look at them, it looks almost like perfect circles, but they're slight ellipses, and that makes the math work a little better. But we still can't make the predictions. We can't plug in numbers and predict the position of where will this be at this point in time. That took until Newton, and Newton has something called the two-body problem. Okay. So Newton solved for the math for this. I took out as much of the math as I could on here. There's still a little bit, but I took out the formulas. Newton basically solved for this and made this work. So in this case, we can say, okay, the blue thing in the middle is the Earth, and that's SkySat 1 around there. So he did the math for that. And that math is actually very elegant. It works very well in a system when there's only two bodies. But there's a problem. That's not actually reflective of reality. There's no actual two-body system. Everything is connected to each other gravitationally. Everything's affecting each other. It turns out to be a huge problem with the math, and it makes things a little crazy. It's what they're called. It's what's called perturbations to the orbit. Basically, perturbations are things that affect that two-body problem. And the big things would be like the sun, the moon, the Earth, even the virtue of the Earth being oblate, which is not a perfect sphere, an oblate spheroid, actually affects that. It's actually measured as a perturbation in itself. It could be like atmospheric drag, little comets that go by. Everything is related to itself. So in reality, we actually have an n-body problem. There's so many things flying around out there that have an effect on this. And if we want a perfect model, we have to throw all of those into the math, into the perturbations formula, which I don't know how to do. I'm not that good at math. And it's literally like rocket science. So not a lot of people can do this, but there's books about it and you can get the concept. So what's useful for us is that we have the what's called this simplified perturbations model, which is abbreviated as SGP4. And the formulas for these were actually released in the 80s. I think it was right in 1980, originally in FORTRAN, which shows you about how old that is. It's been ported to so many things since then, to Java, to C, to MATLAB even. And of course, now it's in JavaScript. People have ported it to JavaScript. And when I say simplified, you know, maybe it's like someone's concept of simplified, but that does not appear to me to be like simplified. It's scary stuff happening. And yeah, this is from satellite.js, so this is a port. This is just a glimpse into the file of what's actually going on. And they left the comments intact. It actually, at the top of the code blocks, it still has comments from the procedures, from the FORTRAN code, and from the port to C++. So it's been ported like crazy. And every time it gets ported, it has a series of tests that you can test it against to make sure that the math is still preserved, even though it's, you know, actually like a port. But it looks pretty crazy. The good news is someone has already ported that, and we could theoretically interface to it in an easy way, which we can. But we need inputs for those functions. So the SGP4 gives us the functions. We still need to put inputs into it. And what we use as inputs are these things called TLEs. So they're two-line element sets. And I show a picture of a punch card, which I also saw way earlier this morning at the beginning of the day. This is where they originated, in punch card land, in the age of mainframe computers that were churning and processing out all these calculations. It turns out we still use the same format. So even when we get to JavaScript land, when we ported everything all the way through, the TLE still preserves the same format as the punch card. It actually, things are spaced out exactly where they've been for so long, like, you know, decades and decades. So it actually, the format exactly resembles it, which is pretty cool. And what I'm doing here is I'm basically saying, okay, the TLE gives us some information about the satellite at a certain point of time. And because this is a simplified model, the math actually deviates over time. So when you have a TLE for a certain day, it's been updated, you get the updated TLE, you plug it into the system, that the math is going to deviate a little. There's going to be some drift day by day. So you have to keep the TLEs up to date. And there's a place online where you can get these for free called CelesTrack. Actually, if you just do a search for any satellite, like your favorite satellite on Google, like SkySat-1 TLE or ISS for International Space Station TLE, they all have TLEs that get updated very frequently because everyone plugs them into their SGP4 models. And this is useful information. It shows us the parts of the, it shows us a little bit about the orbit, what's called eccentricity, inclination, all these things you could look up. I'm not going to explain it. Eccentricity is an interesting one. It actually tells you how far does that orbit deviate from a perfect circle. So there's no perfect circles, of course, but there's crazy orbits, like for spy satellites, that actually are hugely eccentric, that actually the orbit goes way out here, and when it comes back around the Earth, it gets quite close to the Earth, and the purpose is exactly for spying purposes. That's its one purpose. It goes way the heck around, swings around really fast, close to the Earth, and comes out again. So that number would be quite different. But yeah, that gives you an idea of what those represent. I do have a little tool down there. I have a link to it, so you can check it out after. But I do have a tool that kind of helps you, like, educate yourself about how this breaks down. The first line turns out to be more descriptive. It doesn't change much. It tells you what the satellite number is. Like the year it was launched is that 13. 66 is the number of the launch for that year. C is the piece of that launch. So we were also launched with DubaiSat and some other satellites that have a different number. They might be B or D or something like that. 14 is the year that the TLE was generated, so it's in this year. And then 148.177, it's a fractional number for what day of the year is it out of 365 days. So it's quite descriptive, and you can see when it gets out of date by, you know, checking that. So that's our input, that's what we need. We have all the raw materials, and we just have to mash them together now. We're really like standing on the shoulders of giants. So now at this point, okay, we plug them into our functions. So we need to get SGP4 functions in JavaScript. And we have a couple options. I found these two main ones. There's this one thing called iSat, which is a nice NASA-based satellite viewer. The end result of it is actually a WebGL-based nice 3D globe, and it plots the position of any satellite on there. I didn't use it because it's not like a standalone SGP4 library. It's actually, and it's not actually in active development. It has a lot of tests, and it looks like everything's pretty accurate, but it's like, okay, it's just not in development now, so I kind of want to keep my hands off of that. And I am using satellite.js alternatively because it's still in active development. The API is not perfect, but you know, it's getting better. You know, and it serves a single purpose, the purpose that I want. So how do we interface to this? It turns out to be not as clean of an API as we wanted, like ideally. I have to write this little helper wrapper function, this thing that, don't let this frighten you, nothing complicated is happening here. It's called a function called getSatLatLong. So I'm going to plug in a TLE, I'm going to plug in an optional local time. If I don't pass in a local time, it's going to default to whatever is now. And then it's going to take that local time, and this is an important step. You have to convert that to UTC time, which is roughly equivalent to GMT time. There's one catch here. There's an off by one thing in the library, so you have to add one to the JavaScript month. The months in JavaScript are zeroth base, so you just add one, and everything is happy after that. And then there's a lot more to this function actually below, but it's straight up copied from their README, so I didn't really do that much work here. I just have to like sanitize it, massage the data a little bit. All I did is write a nice little wraparound for it. And this is an example of the usage. I plugged in our TLE for the SkySat 1, just plugging it right into the function. So what that's going to return is an array of lat long of the current position of the satellite because I didn't pass in a time. I can optionally pass in whatever time I want, so I could say, in 1 hour, what's going to be the lat long, and it will give that. And then I'm going to do a simple interval on it, nothing too fancy. Every 2 seconds, update it. And for that leaflet marker, update the latitude longitude. And we get something that looks like, I'm having a problem with the videos here. Damn, you get something that should be this, very slight, slightly moving along there. And I put a nice little CSS transition animation on it. So every 2 seconds it gets updated and it kind of jumps a little. So all I did, because Leaflet behind the scenes is doing a translate 3D, I know I can animate that in CSS and I just put a little transition on it, a 2 second transition. So technically the position is a little off by 2 seconds, but it's accurate enough where you get the idea. And it moves pretty gracefully across the screen. Okay, that's cool. And it's supposed to stop there because it's a video. now it would be nice probably to have an orbit line, just because that would be nice. where has the orbit been, you know, for a period of time, and where is it going to be? That's actually quite useful. Could be useful for humanitarian purposes too. We know there's like some event in some country and we want to see, okay, we know SkySat is an imaging satellite. We want to see when's the next opportunity when we can actually take an image of that country. When's the next pass going to be? So this turns out to be quite useful. So we can generate what we call a ground track, which is just a basic orbit line. Nothing too fancy going on here too, so don't be afraid. The steps are basically, how many, so we're gonna piggyback on the thing that's at the very end of this function, which is a polyline. Leaflet polyline accepts an array of latitude longitudes and plots them on a polyline. And so we have to generate all those latitude longitudes, and we have to generate them by step intervals. So I'm gonna say, let's do 1 minute intervals, because that should be pretty enough line, especially when we're zoomed out, it should be pretty smooth. And we're gonna have a time offset. So I'm just gonna say, give me 3 hours in the past and give me 3 hours in the future and plot this orbit line for me. Stick them into this array, that's what that while loop is doing, and stick the polyline on the screen, give it a blue color. And we get something that's a little ugly. So it turns out Leaflet has this problem when the map wraps around, and also when the map goes across the international dateline, it's this famous source of headaches in all of the computations. Where that breaks off there just happens to be the international date boundary. So you can see the lines at the bottom obviously aren't correct. It's not going to jump across there. But with some further refinements, you can get it to a point where it's a little cleaner than that. There's also some distortion. There's some built-in distortion into these maps, actually, because this is a projection of a 3D space of a sphere. So there's actually a huge distortion at the poles, and you can see a little bit of that because our step function isn't precise enough. And near the poles, you can see actually like the lines become even more jagged. That's actually an indication of the map distortion. And that sort of leads to what would be the next steps with, what do I do with this? Like, it actually turns out to be more useful. I don't have time to get into it, but it's actually more intuitive if you go to 3D maps, because you can see the orbits that actually intuitively, logically make more sense. These orbits are kind of crazy because they're a map projection. It doesn't seem right. But with this, you have a couple tools. There's one out there called Cesium. This is what powers what I was talking about before, ISAT. It kind of does all the fun work for you, so you don't have to do, you can customize it, but you don't have to do terribly a lot of work. There's another one that's more customizable with 3JS, which is more of a WebGL type of example, and there's this awesome tutorial that someone other than me did online. They start with a sphere in 3JS, put a little texture around it, put the map texture around it, stretch it around. They get some clouds as a separate layer that they can animate separately. And the nice thing about 3JS, I don't have it here, but you can plug in CAD models in here. So I actually found like the CAD model on the shared drive somewhere of the satellite, which we've actually like, we don't have it there anymore, and I can't show it to you because of, you know, restrictions. But I was able to plug in that CAD model. It was way too big for my purposes because it had all the little detailed components about the satellite inside. But that actually worked very slowly on here, and I could see it floating around up there. So that's what you can springboard off of. You can do all sorts of stuff, and everyone should be able to go through the examples. Again, I have the link posted there, JSConf. It's bit.ly/JSConf-satellite, and that shows all the steps that corresponds to my slides, so through step one to the end. So everyone should be able to load that up and be able to tweak it and play around with it. Yeah, ping me on Twitter if you have any questions or any questions about what I've been working on. Happy to answer. So, yeah, that's about it. Thank you for listening.